Hello, and welcome to another edition of Spoiler Alert right here on 90.3 FM Mawa. My name is Gian, and I'm joined here with my co-host,
Scott. And today we're going to be talking about a movie that's it's a little bit older. Usually we do a film that came out within the past week, but you know, due to spring break, we had that little bit of hiatus.
Spring break, man.
Slip of the tongue. We're going to be talking about 10 Cloverfield Lane, a new horror sci-fi movie that came out. An ostensible sequel to J.J. Abrams' sci-fi film for about, I would say, 10 years ago, Cloverfield.
Maybe 10.
I think it was like 10 years ago.
Possibly.
Something like that. As you can already tell, this is your weekly hour-long segment where two horribly underqualified individuals discuss movies as if they are professionals. So this film, it was made on the cheap. I think it was only 15 mil was in the budget.
It was 15 million.
It's,
And I think it was a decent budget for what they did. Yeah. They were just, the whole film basically took place in a bedroom, a road, on an empty road, and a bunker.
Yeah.
And then outside of a bunker.
Yeah.
In a field.
It was a great example of it's a clear example of you don't need fancy set pieces to make an exciting, thrilling movie.
Absolutely.
This film also, I was very surprised to go back after seeing the film and finding out that it was PG-13, because for the most parts, I find PG-13 movies usually are bad because it'll usually be obvious that they were aiming for an R rating.
Right.
Was
it PG-13?
It was, but
there
was
a lot more.
Usually, you can see where things were cut or how things would have worked better as an R-rated movie.
Yeah, it definitely pushed the envelope.
But
there,
this
though.
Film, flowed so naturally. There were never parts where I was like, they should have added more gore or whatever.
Yeah.
They did it perfectly. It was incredible. I found it.
Should have just been rated R. Should make it rated R.
Because
the stuff they had in there, this should have just been.
Oh, I wouldn't say I'm disputing the rating. I guess what I'm saying is usually PG-13. Movies, basically what I'm saying is that I find that PG-13 movies horror movies as a rule tend to suck.
Mm-hmm.
But this one was really good, and I gotta say, it's one of the scariest movies I've seen in a while.
Yeah, it definitely was.
Do you think it was scarier than The Witch? It might have been for me.
Nah, maybe it was scary because it was realistic,
mm-hmm.
But it wasn't scary in the terms of, spooky or creepy or anything like that. It was just kind of like, oh my god, imagine if that really happened.
Mm-hmm.
Being locked up underground in a bunker. Mm-hmm. That's the scary part. So realistically scary.
Yeah. So you know what? I think I'm gonna give a very brief summary of the movie, then we're gonna jump into a clip from the film.
Sounds
and
good.
then we'll do our usual, we'll break it down, do our thing. So this film, like I said, the title 10 Cloverfield Lane, clearly there it's a spiritual sequel, if nothing else, to the original Cloverfield.
Have you read any articles lately to try to, see if it does have any connection?
No.
I've been trying to separate the two. I didn't want to read anything about it because I feel like once you read, a theory, mm-hmm. it kind of, infects your mind and leaves that imprint of, maybe it is, maybe it's not. That's why, as crazy as it sounds, I don't like reading reviews before I give reviews. Because then I end up, that opinion stays imprinted.
Oh, no, I have a pop, whenever I go into a movie that I gotta write about or talk about, I make it a point to not watch the trailers, not read a review, or anything connected to the film.
Yeah.
So this film, it differs widely from the original Cloverfield.
It's
not first-person handheld camera, which was, the trademark of, that was, the central, gimmick of the first one.
Yeah.
That is not in this film. There are no reoccurring characters. The film does feature aliens like the previous film, but they are totally different design, completely different from the alien that the famous insectoid creature which destroys New York City.
There could be different breeds of alien.
They could be, but I felt
like the way they're people are different, types of, there's different races of people, there's different races of of Alien.
That's very true. No, that's very true. And I guess what I'm saying is just, like, there's just so little that you could connect between the two films.
Right.
The one reference to the original film that I caught was, I remember in the original movie, in the background of scenes, like, people were drinking, like, a certain brand of Slurpee. I think it was called, like, a Slusho Slurpee.
Right.
And in this film, there's a neon sign for that brand of Slurpees. Slushos. And that might actually be, like, a J.J. Abrams thing, because I remember reading, because a couple years ago, when I saw Cloverfield, like, I spent the rest of the night, like, just reading articles on Wikipedia about it. And, like, apparently in J.J. Abrams' TV show Alias, like, Jennifer Garner, in, like, the first episode, she's drinking a Slusho slushy or something.
Really?
Yeah.
So I want to know, what is it that, what's with J.J. Abrams' Slusho slushies?
But, yeah, I remember when the, initially watching the original Cloverfield, like, there's all this, like, backstory and stuff that's available on the internet that's a combination of stuff put out by J.J. Abrams and fan theories and stuff. It's pretty interesting.
It's funny, they have a Cloverpedia.
Yeah.
Cloverpedia of Slusho. Slusho, the Slusho drinks are a classic slush beverage with special ingredient that seabed nectar, giving it a high addictive quality. They have, like, it's a whole, like, thing. I don't know if this is real, though.
Oh, it's not a real product.
No, it's not a real product, but, like, somebody decided to give it a real, like, an actual product description.
No, I remember that, because part of the people...
There's even flavors.
Yeah, because people were arguing about whether the alien from the original Cloverfield came from space or came from the bottom of the ocean. And people were like, well, the Slusho flavor... they get its secret ingredient from the bottom of the ocean for whatever reason.
No, it's like ingredient. It's seabed nectar.
And they woke up the alien.
This is with sodium. There's vitamin E, citric acid. There's like a whole...
They have like an ingredients list?
Yeah, ingredient list is flavors. Blueberry Zoom, Chocolate Rage.
Chocolate Rage.
Strawberry Tasty, which a Western only flavor. Three Western only flavor. Like, it's so weird.
Oh,
J.J. Abrams must have put that out. I guess you can do that, though, when you're, like, banging out, like, hit movies.
What, fake recipes for Slusho slushies?
Yeah, you can do, like, whatever you want.
You can. But anyway, so, before we lose, you know, the rest of our audience that's still listening in, so this film centers around a young woman. Her name is Michelle. She is given a name. Michelle.
Just Michelle. Played by Mary Elizabeth...
Winstead.
I was going to butcher that. I was going to say Winstead.
Who is awesome, but I'll get back to that. So, you know, the opening for this film is great. With very quickly, with no dialogue, very economically, we see that she's had a falling out with her boyfriend and that she's dry.
I think it was
Fiance, yes, because she leaves the ring.
Yeah.
And she's driving to who knows where.
And the fiance is played by Bradley Cooper.
This was something that Gian picked. You want to tell us about this?
Okay, I will. All right, so I have a theory that J.J., well, Bradley Cooper...
Well, I thought this was fact.
This is a fact. No, it's a fact. I'm breaking it down deeper than to what it is.
Okay.
Bradley Cooper played a detective on J.J. Abrams' show Alias.
Okay.
That was, like, one of his early roles. So I'm guessing that they're really good buddies, and he called him up to play. He just plays a voice on the phone. He plays Ben, Michelle's ex-husband, calling her on the phone.
Her fiance.
Fiance.
Well, no, what cracks me up is that Bradley Cooper, so much of his fame is derived from being the, like, the dude in romantic comedies.
Yeah.
So I just love it that in this, he's the sleazy ex-boyfriend on the
telephone.
But
he plays a voice. That's the thing.
Which is pretty great.
I get kind of annoyed, like, because how much did he get paid to play a voice? Like the way Jonah Hill in Hail Caesar played a guy just pulling a lever. Like, how much did these guys get paid?
I feel that Jonah Hill probably got paid. I'm sure Jonah Hill got paid for Hail Caesar. But, like, in this film, like, I'm thinking, like, if J.J. Abrams has already worked with Bradley Cooper.
Yeah.
Like, that's...
He's like a buddy favor.
Yeah, I feel like a voice on a phone, that's not a role you have to audition for.
He's in the cast.
It would take 5 minutes. I'm sure it was just like, hey, you know what? Yeah. Let's do this little Easter egg.
I guess.
Bradley Cooper.
Definitely was an Easter egg. Good point. It was an Easter egg. And John Goodman plays our creepy guy.
John Goodman,
Howard Stambler? It's Stambler. It's pronounced Stambler. Howard Stambler.
John Goodman, who I think is a great actor, who occasionally delivers so-so performances. I thought he was phenomenal in this film. In fact, I want to really go in deep to his character in a little bit. But before that, let me get through just kind of the beginning of this film. So, like I said, in great fashion, we see that she's had a falling out with her fiancé.
Right.
She's driving to who knows where. It doesn't really matter.
Yeah, I wish there were a direction where she was going.
And distracted by a phone call from her ex, she gets T-boned by a pickup truck, which we later learn is being driven by John Goodman.
Well, he was trying to... He came from behind.
Yeah.
Came from behind and, like, hit her.
Whacked her right off.
Supposedly trying to pass her.
I have a theory that... John Goodman admits that he accidentally ran into her. Mm-hmm. I have a theory that he was planning to do it. Like, it was a much more planned act, in the sense, which I'll get to. But anyway, so you feel the car crash coming. Mm-hmm. I feel like that's been a trick that that we've seen in a lot of films in recent years.
But it's the way it's shot as well, because in that scene, they draw you into the phone call.
Definitely.
They give you, like, the point of view shot of her looking down into the phone.
Yeah.
His name comes up. So what you're doing is you're thinking about, if I'm in my car, I'm looking down at my cup holder because the phone's there, and mm-hmm. your attention is drawn there. And then it brings it back up to the rear view mirror where she sees lights, she's confused, and there's the bang.
Yeah, oh, don't get me wrong.
And everything's, like, super close, so it's, like, it's extra, like, surprising.
Oh, yeah, what I'm saying is, like, I guess this scene, like, we've seen it many times in the past couple of few years. It's, like, that does not detract from the horror and the effectiveness of it.
Right.
It's incredibly loud, incredibly scary, and what's great about this is that you get the initial impact of the truck hitting the car.
Yeah, you feel like you're in an accident.
Cuts out to the title card. Goes back to the crash.
I didn't like that.
Cuts to production. Goes back to the crash.
That
cuts
was weird. It took
director
me out.
Card.
It took me out of the whole
really?
Movie. Yeah.
I really like that little trick.
Because I've told a lot of people this, that when I go to see a film, I base my opinion on the film on how well of a job it does removing me from reality.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning that I'm completely submerged in it, and I forget that it's a production.
Yeah.
I forget that there's a budget, I forget that there's a director, there's a camera guy, all that. And when it did that, it removed me for a minute. And it left me, like, disoriented. Maybe that was the idea.
I think that was the idea, because for me, I feel like it happened early enough in the film where we weren't so invested that it just drew us right out.
Yeah.
But, like, I thought that it was disorienting because, like...
It was silence.
It was silent. It was disorienting. It was the opposite of what you expected. For me, it just added... I really enjoyed that.
I guess it was well executed.
It was.
If it were another, it was another film done another way, it might not have been as effective.
Yeah.
But with the loud crashing mixed with the moment of silence and then a crash and then silence...
I feel like if they didn't do that, if they just let the crash play out, I definitely feel I would have felt cheated, because I have seen similar scenes recently. I feel like a very similar scene is in Whiplash. I feel another similar scene we see often is, like, I feel like I've seen countless feature-length films and short films where, like, characters unexpectedly get ran over by cars.
And the title card comes in or something.
Yeah, and, like, I think
Quentin Tarantino actually does some stuff like that sometimes.
Does he?
I felt like in one of those Kill Bill movies, he might have done it. There was, like, something went on, and then he, like, threw in a title card, or, like, he threw in something. It reminds me of something Quentin Tarantino has done.
Yeah.
Can't put my, like, finger on it, but something similar.
Well, I don't mean it being intercut by a title card. It, like, half of these scenes, other similar scenes that I'm thinking of have happened towards the end or midway through a movie. It's just, like, they're shot in a very specific way. Like, obviously, it's very hard for me to describe on air, but, like, in my head, I have a very clear image of how the scene works out. It's, like, it's a formula.
Isn't it funny how, like, I find it really weird how we break things down mm-hmm. into shots.
Yeah.
When you study the films, you end up cutting, you break everything down into shots in your head when you start thinking about it.
Mm-hmm.
It's a weird process. I'll get back to characters.
Let's go back to what this movie is about.
Two more characters.
So she wakes up chained to the wall of a creepy underground bunker, which we realize is owned and inhabited by John Goodman as Howard. Very creepy guy. I loved Howard's character as well as John Goodman's portrayal.
Mm-hmm. And his plumpness. Added to his creepiness.
It did, and I'm not being facetious when I say John Goodman being fat added to this character.
Yeah.
That's something I'll delve into later down the road, but let me quick round out the cast. The other character is a kind of like a good-natured, redneck-y, kind of like...
John, his name's Emmett. Emmett DeWitt, played by John Gallagher. He's not like a well-known actor.
Yeah, I've never heard of him, but he's just like a jocular, good-natured... handyman who built the bunker for John Goodman and is seemingly completely under his sway.
Yeah.
And now that I think about it, they are literally the only three people you see on screen. No, I take that back. Yeah, there is the crazy woman.
Yeah, her name is Leslie, the infected woman.
Yeah, she appears very briefly, but besides that, these are like the only three people you see on screen.
And you know what? It was really well. Sometimes I wonder, like, if having a small cast takes away from a film. It did great for it.
Oh, it didn't. Like,
a small cast.
And I think, to the film's credit, like, it only now just dawned on me that the cast was so small.
Yeah.
Because you're so invested in the characters. I did have a few minor problems with the writing for Emmett. Some of his dialogue felt a little clunky or on the nose for me.
Yeah, I feel that. I think the focus was on... the other two characters.
It was.
Emmett kind of played like this weird third wheel role to the film.
Yeah, but you know what? Despite some problems I had with the writing of his character, you ultimately become very invested in him. I would definitely not write him off as a character. So basically, the source of the drama comes from John Goodman's psychotic nature.
Yeah.
And, the conflict between him and Michelle, who wants to get out but can't leave the bunker because John Goodman won't let her, and the air outside seems to be polluted. Some type of attack has occurred.
Right.
John Goodman, who's like this crazy conspiracy guy, end
he's
of the world,
throwing out all these different
end of days guy. He's like, he has all these theories. He thinks it's Korea, some type of foreign government, aliens. He has all these theories. And a part of the film is the audience and Michelle trying to figure out whether or not the outside world is actually...
Yeah.
Has actually been destroyed.
And all they know is what this guy is telling them.
Yeah.
And they believe him because they have no one else to believe.
I would say the next... I feel like Emmett believes him. Like, but Michelle is very skeptical.
Emmett came in from the outside.
Yeah.
He knew what was going on the outside.
Mm-hmm.
He knew that... Well, I guess... spoil it, obviously, that there was an alien attack,
mm-hmm.
and Emmett saw it and experienced it, and then he came, he fought his way into the bunker.
Yeah. And I would say that, the more I think about it, like, for me, like, I feel like normally, like, if you told me that aliens came out of seemingly nowhere in the final few minutes of the film, if someone were to tell me that, I'd say that sounds like a horrible, like, cheap, like, reversal.
Yeah.
But I really bought it. It felt very organic for
it
me.
Did.
To me. I think that could do in part because of the title of the film, it being a sequel to Cloverfield that mm-hmm. sets you up, that prepares you for there being extraterrestrials running around.
It could have gone bad, though. It could have gone, like, totally bad, and it could have just fallen apart. But it worked out. I believe it, too.
There was not a minute where I took a step back and went, wait a minute. Like, I was so invested. I was so in that world when the aliens appeared. Like, I just rolled with it, which I think is a triumph on the film's part.
Yeah, for sure. And I like how the aliens don't play exactly... a major, major role in the film.
Mm-hmm.
They play, what are they, the last 20 minutes to 25, maybe half hour, the aliens are gone.
Do you think it was that long?
Less?
I think it was...
20 minutes?
I think it was like 20 minutes.
I looked at the clock, because I timed the movie out, because, when you time the movie, you can kind of tell the flow of how things are going.
Yeah.
And the last, like, in the last 10 minutes, she defeated the aliens and was on the road, already on her way to Houston in the last 10 minutes. So maybe 20 minutes from the minute the aliens appeared, from when she was on top of the truck and the aliens flew in.
But it was really good. You know what? I've got my eye on the time. It's 8:50 right now.
You want to play that clip?
We're gonna play the clip. Okay. And then we're gonna come back, and I think we're gonna play our first song of the night. Mm-hmm. Break it up a little earlier than usual.
Sounds good.
So let me boot up the old computer here. Come on, there we go. And okay, so here's a clip from Cloverfield. As usual, we're experiencing technical difficulties of some sort.
It'll happen. It's all right.
There we go.
Got it? Mm-hmm. Turn up in here in the house?
Mm-hmm. Turn it off. I don't understand.
There's been an attack. A big one. I'm not sure yet if it's chemical or nuclear. But down here, we're safe.
I was driving north of here.
You were in an accident. I saved your life, Michelle.
Thank you so much for saving my life. I guess I should go to a hospital now.
You can't leave.
Alrighty, that was a clip. Alrighty, that was a clip from 10 Cloverfield Lane. John Goodman and Mary Elizabeth Winstead there. John Goodman, that's kind of our introduction to his character.
Yeah.
You know what? This film, like, I gotta say, if it's not obvious already, like, I really enjoyed this film.
Yeah, I know you did.
I could talk forever about the direction of this film, but I think when we come back from our first musical interlude, I'm going to be talking a lot about the actors and character. But right now, we got our first number up. I think we're going to go with Gian's pick.
I'm going to do mine. My pick this week was inspired by my buddy here, Christina, in studio. Believe.
Now,
by Cher.
By Cher. We got some Cher coming at you. And before we play Believe, Gian, as we walked into the studio, was telling us he has a new impression. It's Cher singing Hotline Bling. Can we get... I have not heard this.
All right, hold up,
yet. Can we get a taste of this?
And I know when Hotline Bling, I can only mean one thing. Oh my god. It's better in the shower. I can't do it.
All right, so that was Gian performing Hotline Bling by Cher. Now, here's a more well-known song of Cher's. Here we go.
And welcome back to Spoiler Alert here on 90.3 FM Mawa. How you doing, Scott?
You know what? I'm doing good. Gian.
That's good.
I'm peachy.
Makes me feel good that you're doing good.
You know what? Yeah. Alrighty, so I am just itching to talk about John Goodman's character and his portrayal of said character. Then we're gonna dive into Gian wants to deconstruct the storyline of this film.
Break it down.
So like I said, the last John Goodman film Break it down. The last John Goodman film I saw, I don't know, it was like John Goodman and, like, Tommy Lee Jones, and it was, like, some, like, direct-to-video, like, film that was really bad, if I remember correctly. So...
John Goodman has not been in a lot of good
films. He was in Monsters Incorporated, man. Don't talk about John Goodman.
Yeah.
He played Sully.
Okay. Yeah, okay. I mean, but like, actor, like, you know what I mean? Like,
I think he's had some great roles.
Yeah.
Walter Sobchak from The Big Lebowski.
Oh, he was in The Flintstones. Now, Flintstones wasn't that good, though.
That was a live-action movie?
That was a live-action movie.
Wow.
Wow! Guess what the budget was for Flintstones? Getting way off track. Guess what the budget was?
10 million.
No, 46 million.
Oh, so it was a big budget movie.
Guess how much it made?
25.
341.6 million. That makes no sense. That can't be real. Flintstones, a live action movie.
Wow.
You know, you never seen that one?
No, I didn't know it existed.
You gotta check that out. What year is that from? That's 94.
Okay. Alrighty. So going back to John, like, so yeah, last time I saw John Goodman in a movie, you know, his performance left a bad taste in my mouth. But he kills it in this film. He is phenomenal. I feel like a danger for big name actors is when you see them in a film, you don't see them as their character, you see them as themselves.
Yep.
It's like when I watched Fight Club, like, I was like, yo, it's Ed Norton, but sometimes he's Brad Pitt. Like, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. I didn't think of them as, like, these other characters. But, John Goodman, you believe that, you know, he is this man, Howard. And just, like, the writing of his character and John Goodman's portrayal is just so spot on. Of this person who clearly they're not normal. I don't know if I would say they're psychopathic or, well, I think John Goodman, spoiler alert, turns out John Goodman has killed at least two people, if at not least. More.
Might have killed his daughter, maybe.
Yeah, it turns out he's a psychopath or... Yeah, I don't know my psychological definitions, but yeah. So he's just quirky.
He's not 100% in the head.
But yeah, I guess what I love about John Goodman's character is, like, I've met people like this character, where something is not right with them. There's a clear difference between how they view the world and how they view themselves, and what is actually going on around them. You know, he has an inflated sense of, you know, his own importance, and intelligence. He behaves according to, society's, mores as he sees them.
Right.
But they're clearly how he interprets them. I don't think he quite understands them.
I have a quote here in the description of John Goodman by Brian Rocha.
Did he just text you?
No, he texted me earlier today. Okay. He says, John Goodman plays that sympathetic, quickly violent, kind of rapey and haunty character to perfection.
Brian Rocha, you just hit the nail on the head.
Yeah, so he did. He played that. He did. Quickly violent. Kind of like off the handle at any moment.
Yeah. This character, you know, he doesn't... you know, he's someone who does not understand how his fellow human beings work, or how society works, or what people are feeling, but he pretends as if he does, or he thinks that he or maybe he's fooled himself and he thinks he knows, you know, what makes a person tick, but he's clearly, he's not, like, something's wrong with him, like he's just this off, wacky creepy character.
Man. He's a creepy dude.
Yeah, John Goodman, like, I have nothing but praise for his performance in this film.
Yeah, he did
phenomenal.
A really good job. It was funny. Brian...
John Goodman has redeemed himself in my eyes.
Brian told me earlier, he was like, when John Goodman goes and shaves and comes back... John Goodman has a beard in this film. But there's a point where he goes and shaves and comes back with a...
But you don't see him shave. He just appears he beardless, just, and you're like, oh, my God.
Beardless, with his hair combed.
Yeah.
And he says, when John Goodman shaved, that's when you know it's going down.
And you know what? It's funny, it's true. That, like, that beat when John Goodman enters the room.
His shift. In
having
the,
shot someone in the face.
He shot Emmett with the third person that was in there.
Comes out in a new, you know, fresh set of clothes, hair combed, freshly shaved. Like, Brian's, our buddy Brian Rocha's description of that moment is hilarious, but it is scary in that moment in the film.
Especially because...
Just that visual, he doesn't even say anything, and you see that, you know, how he's groomed himself.
Yeah, he just comes back creepy and clean.
It's scary. He went from being scruffy and creepy to clean-shaven and, like, even scarier.
But especially from, I guess... I mean, I can't really say, but from the character, from, like, she, She's a female. She's smaller than this guy. This is a big John Goodman's a big fat guy. His character.
Yeah.
And she's kind of scared of him because she doesn't know how violent or how like when what will break him.
Yeah. Well, he's so intimidating.
Yeah.
Like I don't even talk about the fact that he has a gun on.
Yeah, he carries a gun at all times.
That's besides. He's just this. You know, he just fills up the space that he's in. Partly because of his body mass index, partly because of his acting ability. Yeah. He just chews the scenery.
He does this weird thing where he wants everyone to be appropriate.
Yeah.
He wants everyone to act a certain way, talk a certain way, no cursing, no touching. Yeah, all these weird
quirks. He's very infantile. He's infantile. The bunker, this is, every man's home is his castle, and John Goodman takes that to heart. He is lord and master of his little fantasy kingdom he's built below the earth.
Yeah.
And when, you know, these other characters, Emmett and Michelle, when they don't act with how he wants them to act, like, he blows a fuse. Emmett, when he first appears, I wasn't impressed. I was, like, I felt his dialogue and his character was a little clunky.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know if it was through I suppose it was the actor's performance, but, like, by the time Emmett gets around to getting his face blown off, I know I at least was deeply invested in him and really cared for him as a character.
But I think Emmett, his character was supposed to be like that. He was kind of like this, like, hillbilly. He told Michelle at one point, I live my life in a 40-mile radius, and I've always kept it that way. And he seemed like this very small-town mechanic guy, got the beard, got the trucker, dirty trucker hat.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? He's just this small-town guy that's kind of just simple. Simple guy.
Yeah, but he's a sympathetic guy. Like, he's like the everyman. Like, you can't help but not like him, is what I'm saying.
But he became kind of like Michelle's, like, sidekick there for a little while.
Yeah, and I thought they had yeah, I really like their relationship, how they're just, like, these two people, like, you're just rooting for them.
Yeah,
you want, are. And, like, it's just very simple. Like, these guys, they're just good people, like, and, you know, we don't go too in-depth into their backstories. This is just the situation they're in.
Yep.
How are they going to get out of it? It gels. It's great.
And I like how they don't get romantically involved or anything.
No.
They don't fall in love. There's nothing of that.
No, they're just two people. They got to survive.
Exactly. It's all about survival.
I feel like you can draw a lot of parallels between Mary Elizabeth Winstead's character, Michelle, with Ellen Ripley, of Sigourney's Weaver's iconic character from the Alien franchise, in that, well, obviously they're both women killing aliens. That's number one. But what I'm saying is, like, you know, they're besides, like, I mean, these parallels, I guess what I'm saying is they're sci-fi female characters, you know, killing aliens, but the parallels can be drawn how their portrayals are very well done. They're not hypersexualized or anything. Like, they're very human and very real characters that, are equal to or better than all the male characters on the screen. I'll come back to Mary Elizabeth Winstead later as like that. She directly ties into my music choice for the night. More on that later. But Gian wanted to deconstruct the story a bit more.
Right.
So let's do that.
So the last point we touched upon in order of the storyline was the fact that she ended up in the bunker. She's locked up in the bunker. Right off the bat, Howard, John Goodman, he starts to take care of her. He gives her fluids. He brings her food. He had, obviously, her knee was hurt, so he gave her a knee brace. And kind of, he chained her up to the wall, which was a little, like, you kind of remove the fact that he was trying to help her, and you automatically turn it into, like, keeping, it's like a hostage situation.
Mm-hmm.
And so from there, she attempts to break free. There's several attempts for her to break free. She, John Goodman gives her a pair of, what are they?
Crutches.
Crutches. And they're wooden crutches. She ends up trying to shave one down to use it as, like, kind of a weapon. And she attempts to take down John Goodman. Totally backfires on her. And then from there, John Goodman never, like, he got mad that she would try to, like, break free and, like, turn on him. But he never got to the point where was like, yo, you're trying to kill me. Like, you just tried to kill me, like, 3 times now. Like, why? Like, he never got to a point where it was like...
Well, because for John Goodman, like, that was his weakness. Is because for him, Michelle, in his deranged mind, is the replacement for the daughter that was lost.
Right, because she's, like, my daughter.
Yeah, and there's a great scene when you're slowly starting to unravel that, you know, all is not as it seems with John Goodman. And, you know, slowly learn about his daughter. Mm-hmm. There was a great moment where he was talking about his daughter and, like, oh, you know, where is she now? She's like, and he's just like, he states, like, this is one of many little cues where we see, like, John Goodman, you know, he's kind of a wacky guy. No. Is because she's like, so where is she now? He's like, she moved to Chicago. And he's like, he just states matter-of-factly as if it's totally normal. He's just like, yeah, her mother turned her against me. And, like...
That was probably a fake story.
Oh, I don't think the story was fake. I think, like, John Goodman's wife was like, yo, I'm married to a whack job. I'm going to divorce him and keep my daughter safe.
I think so.
I think that was a true story. I think, like, but what I'm saying is, like, John Goodman, like, you never tell somebody, like, you've just met, like, you know, my child doesn't love me because my ex-wife turned her against me.
Yeah.
Like, that's just a clear sign that you are a nut job.
Yeah. He was nuts.
I'm sorry, so...
From there... several attempts to break free. There were, and then after that, they became a little more... They started to calm down a bit, because there's a point where he tells her, you need to go outside and take a look for yourself. And there were two dead pigs outside that had been, like, eaten by, like, an alien or some type of life form.
It was as if the atmosphere had, like, eroded at them. You know what I mean? Like,
they're rotting. They're rotting pigs. And that made her think, whoa, okay. Because the whole thing was John Goodman was telling them that the air was polluted. Mm-hmm. That was his theory. The air is polluted. You can't go outside. The air is polluted. So that really made her think that, wow, maybe actually something is going on. Just dead, rotting pigs outside. That's not normal.
Yeah.
So she started to calm down a bit. But then she decides... Oh, after that, she meets Emmett.
Yeah.
She meets Emmett, and they become kind of buddies. And Emmett kind of sees Howard, John Goodman, as just, like, a regular guy. Like, he helped him build the bunker and everything.
Like, kind of like a sure, he's a little wacky, but he's just a crazy old guy.
Exactly. Right? He's, like...
Harmless.
Everyone knows he's a little crazy, but we don't think he's that bad. And so, from there... You see the wheels turning in her face continuously throughout. She's always planning things and looking around and seeing ways that she can get out.
Yeah.
And then there's a point where she sees the keys.
Yeah.
And she makes, you see her planning to grab the keys at one point.
Yeah.
So
in a great, very tense scene, where she attempts to, escape.
Yeah. And then from there, she plans out the whole thing. She breaks a bottle over his face. What happens? She kind of finds out. She starts talking to Emmett in a way that starts to create some type of jealousy in the room, and Howard becomes violent because of this, thinking that Michelle is not appreciative of everything he's done for her.
Oh, when she tries to steal the keys?
Well, yeah.
Because she's explicitly, because, it's clear. She realizes that John Goodman is not comfortable with any touchy-feely things going on in his bunker. So she clearly begins to flirt with
Emmett.
With Emmett, who's just kind of like, what are you doing? And she's doing it because she knows it's going to set John Goodman off. And when it does, she's able to snatch the keys, which lead to the outside world. Also, about this movie, she and Emmett eventually build a homemade
hazmat suit.
Hazmat suit,
because they know they, They don't know that the air outside is contaminated, mm-hmm. but they're planning for it.
All right, so this film featured two things that I am a sucker for in films. One, a good montage. Mm-hmm. I love montages in movies. Like, they're playing this old song, and they're just, like, doing their thing around the bunker, like, playing board games and stuff. Yeah. And I was like, I was just sitting in the movie theater going, like, God, I love montages. This is so great. And the other thing they do in this movie is I love it in movies when they make awesome stuff out of just, like, everyday items. Like, if, like...
Homemade.
I don't care if the movie sucks, but, like, when, like, somebody, like, I don't know, like, makes a rocket launcher out of duct tape and, like, PVC pipe, mm-hmm. I am sold. And this film was, like MacGyver stuff. Like...
For homemade,
I live for that.
Tools.
I love that, like, just, like, oh, I'm gonna make something awesome out of, like, ordinary stuff. And that happens several times in this film. Like, you know, they make the hazmat suit.
And I love the way
they made the hazmat suit... Like, they out of a shower curtain, duct tape, and a 2-liter soda bottle.
It's nuts.
And, like, she's running around in this thing, and I was just like, it's so good.
Go, girl.
I'm not sure if I was saying that. A little bit. I was just watching her wear that. I just had this, like, deep sense of satisfaction, like...
I like the way they got the shower curtain.
Yeah, that was a good scene.
The whole way in a certain point in the film, the air filtration system goes down,
mm-hmm.
and they put her into the vent, and she goes to the vents, comes back, and Emmett sells it to Howard that, oh, Michelle just took a shower. She's probably full of the contaminants from the air and everything.
Yeah,
it's probably all over the shower. You should probably go do something about that. Yeah. And he falls for it, he goes and he takes down the shower curtain, throws it in the trash, and then I like how they cut from him throwing it in the trash to then Michelle and Emmett opening it, prying it out,
mm-hmm.
and getting to work, going into your montage.
Yeah. I love montages. like I said, my perfect movie, like, it would have at least one montage, possibly two, and the main character would, like, make all sorts of cool stuff out of, like, the items around him or her.
Mm-hmm.
Like in the beginning, like, she fashions, like the spear out of the crutch.
Right.
And then I feel like there was something else she made.
There was that? I think it was just that in the hazmat suit.
Yeah, maybe it was just that, but, like, oh, so good.
Yeah, she's creative.
So great. Like, the soda, like, I felt the soda bottle for the face mask was just so genius, because it, like, you could totally see how, like, one would natural, like, how one could visualize that in their head. And
right, it totally made sense.
It was great. You know what, I'm looking at the clock yet again, it's 9:17, I think we're going to go into our second musical interlude.
Go for it.
And before that, I'm going to give a little preface before I play my song of the night. So, Mary Elizabeth Winstead is known first and foremost as an actress, but this was actually the first movie that I've seen her in. I've actually known her for several years for a music album she released a couple years ago, called Got a Girl. I'm sorry, the album title is I Love You, But I Must Drive Off This Cliff Now. And it's,
This is called?
Yeah, and it's the album's by a duo called Got a Girl, and it's Mary Elizabeth Winstead on vocals, and what's his name? Dan the Automator, I think that's his name, a famous DJ. And it's this album that's just this ode to classic, like, 1960s, like, lounge and club music.
Oh, nice.
So, like a lot of, like, string arrangements.
Yeah.
And just her with this, like, very sexy voice. Like, this album is, like, it wants me to, like, every time I listen to it, like, you gotta, like, dim the lights and, like, put on a tuxedo and drink a martini. Like, that's the kind of music this is. So, you know, before we play this, I'm just gonna shamelessly shill for this movie, this album. Like, people, go out there, buy I Love You, But I Must Drive Off This Cliff Now, because it's awesome. So, before we play, one of the tracks from the album, track 8, Put Your Head Down, I'm just gonna, you know, like, slow things down, just tell everyone to dim the lights, you know, get comfortable. You know, I'm assuming you're in front of a roaring fireplace, because you should be listening to this type of music. lay down on the bearskin rug that you have at your feet, and just be swept away, man, by
put your shirt over your shoulder.
By some Mary Elizabeth Winstead and Dan the Automator on Got a Girl.
Want me to bring it in? You're gonna bring it in.
What?
You're gonna bring it in?
Yeah, a little bit. I'll bring it in, yeah. Alrighty, that was Got a Girl with Put Your Head Down on 90.3 FM WRPR.
Good pick.
Spoiler alert, talking about 10 Cloverfield Lane. That song, like, I feel like that song, I feel like their music is dangerous. Like, I feel like if I walked into a crowded public space and played their music on a boombox, I feel like everybody around me would just start having sex.
Or break into, like, a nice, like, slow dance.
That's what I envision.
Scott went straight to, like, sex.
You haven't heard the rest of the songs on this album, man.
I'm gonna check it out. And then iTunes?
Probably, yeah.
Or SoundCloud?
Yeah. I had to get it on vinyl, because the kind of music it is.
Like, really?
Yeah, I feel like it deserves,
how's,
like,
it sound on vinyl?
Oh, great. Alrighty, so
7 minutes.
Back from Scott's erotic fantasies, back to the real world.
Now we know, if you're out there listening...
10 Cloverfield Lane.
If you're on Netflix and chill with Scott, that's what's going to be playing in the background.
You know, like, so if you walk into my room and, like, that's playing, you know what's on my mind.
It's just, you know what you're there for.
Alrighty, okay, let's bring it back to the movie. Right,
we're going to start. We're going to give it some stars to close it out.
Alrighty.
Well, let's get back to the fact that, spoiling alert, in the end, she escapes the bunker, she fights the aliens, she brings out an alien ship with a Molotov cocktail.
Oh, that's the other thing. Like, yeah, she's making homemade weapons.
She'll sell the third one.
She makes a Molotov cocktail. It's awesome.
So that's how it ends. She brings down the alien ship, and she drives off to Houston to help other people fight aliens. Okay, the story. Want me to go first?
Go for it, man.
I want to give this one a 9.5. 9.5.
I am right on with that, man. 9.5. I think I had a couple of nitpicky problems, things that I personally would change, but I think they were so small that they were entirely subjective. This, I enjoyed the heck out of this movie. It's a 9.5.
I would have given it a 10 if...
Maybe even a 9.8. Who knows?
All right, so you're almost there at a 10.
Yeah.
I give it a 9.5 because I would have given it a 10 if it was an R rating.
Yeah.
That would have given it a lot of more room for story and violence and all the little things that were shown but not fully explored because of the rating.
The one thing, like, going back to that, like I said, when I see a PG-13 horror movie, it's usually obvious. Like, while watching the movie, you can see where it could have been better if they had the license to go and show you more.
Yep. It's that and the fact that the ending. If the ending weren't so open-ended, it would have sat a little more better with me. I like the fact that she's going off to Houston to help people.
Yeah.
It opens up the availability to create a sequel.
Yeah.
Which, if they do create a sequel, my rating will go up to maybe like a 9.7 because it sits better with me. The story continues, but the fact that it was so open ended, it leaves me thinking, like, if they don't come out with a sequel, it's gonna kind of like, it's not gonna be that. It's gonna, like, it's gonna suck because it's just like, oh, we know she's going to Houston, but what happens in Houston? Tell us.
I actually really like that ending.
Yeah.
Because, well, for me, it's like, She comes out of the bunker to a world that's nothing that she's ever seen before. It's almost completely destroyed.
Yeah.
She can't just go back to her home and resume normal life, you know what I'm saying? Like, she can't really do anything else but ride off into the sunset, which is what she does, in a great shot where claps of thunder and lightning illuminate the gigantic spaceship looming above the country. I really like that. In fact, I'm scared about a sequel to this film that follows her character because I feel like the situation that she's driving off to go be in is one where she's running around shooting aliens with some type of gun.
That's true.
Which to me, that's a scenario we've seen in hundreds of other movies.
Mm-hmm.
What I would love to see a sequel to this film, but I would like to see a sequel that's completely unrelated.
Right.
I really liked the fact that this film had almost nothing to do with Cloverfield. I thought that was a gutsy move. I really dug that. Yeah. If they make a sequel, I hope they do the same thing.
Right.
Totally unrelated incident.
Well, they're doing pretty good in the box office, so why not? I mean, if they don't like money, then don't do it, but it's coming along nicely.
Yeah, about this movie. Right, this might be pushing the limits of what I can say on the radio, but this film, like I said, there's a lot of parallels can be drawn between Michelle and Ripley from the Alien films. They also, in their alien design, well, their aliens looked nothing, for the most, like, nothing like the classic alien from the Alien films.
Right.
Like, they took, like, H.R.R., H.R. Geiger's, like, psychosexual, like, creepy, like, Freudian symbology in his Alien.
Okay.
And just, like, amped it up in this film. Like, you're watching this film, and like for me, when she threw that Molotov cocktail, I was like,
yeah, I
was like, she's throwing a Molotov cocktail right into an alien's vagina. That's what that's
what I saw.
I did.
And when those aliens looked like male genitalia,
you think so?
I think so.
You thought it looked like...
aliens did, yeah.
You thought it looked like a member.
With legs.
I actually didn't get that.
I did. Oh, whoops.
I thought it looked like a... Like, it was hard to tell, like, what kind of legs it had. It was, like, this weird grub thing.
It was like a bear. Grub bear.
Maybe
that's why it looked like a man's thing, because it was a grub... Like, it was like a bear grub.
A grub. And did it have, like, diamond studs on it or something?
Leather? It could have been leather.
It was like this weird... They definitely had like a biomechanical feel. You know what? Very much kind of like Alien. Where like if you study the Alien... It's so redundant.
It was Steve Madden leather. Alien. Their skin was alien.
The giant spaceship that resembles a certain part of the female anatomy. That's like part... It's like part Millennium Falcon, part reproductive organ, and part like Japanese porn tentacle monster.
Absolutely, I saw that.
Yeah,
I did.
And on that note, it's 9:30. You're listening to WRPR 90.3 FM. Have a good night, everybody. We'll see you next week when we remove another. When we butcher yet another film.
Good night, all.
I think it's going to be Batman v Superman.
Most likely.
Alrighty, we'll catch y'all then. We hope if you have any sense, you won't turn in. But the gesture's nice. We hope you join us.
I do. That's how you say bye, right?
It
means bye.
What does?
I don't know.